Welcome to this month's edition of Breaking Down Barriers, where we tackle the research and social stigma barriers that exist within the HD community and even further beyond. And today I have the absolute pleasure of having with me one of the experts in the field with how HD impacts young people, Dr. Karen Anderson. Dr. Anderson, welcome and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much, Jenna.
Well, we have a topic that can kind of, not kind of, that is really challenging to talk about for many people. And that is the topic around suicidal ideation and self-harm. And the unfortunate thing about it is that is a reality in some cases with Huntington's disease. And it's our collective belief that having these conversations actually can help better equip you as an individual, as you are facing some challenging times through the many ebbs and flows of HD's impacts, but also as you are maybe helping support others within the community as well. So we want to break down the barrier and the stigma about not talking about suicidal ideation and self-harm to bring this conversation to the light of openness and sharing and knowing that you're not alone and arming you and equipping you with those resources. Before we get into that topic, though, we'd love to have Dr. Anderson introduce herself and share a little bit about how she got engaged with the HD community.
Sure. So I'm a psychiatrist. I work at Georgetown University. I specialize in an area called neuropsychiatry, which is care of people who have neurological disease, but focus on emotional and cognitive symptoms. And I've been at Georgetown as the director of our Huntington's Disease Society of America Center of Excellence for about 10 years now. We have a wonderful multidisciplinary team there. I'm very incredibly lucky to work with wonderful colleagues in neurology, genetics, outreach, social work, physical therapy. It's a terrific team. And I started working in Huntington's disease way back in 1996, 97, when I was a psychiatry resident at Columbia. I was all set to work in Alzheimer's disease. I thought that was going to be the rest of my life's work. I did an elective in the Huntington's clinic as their psychiatrist because they had a gap in psychiatric care. And I found Huntington's to be so interesting, I never left. So it was just one of those happy accidents of fate that I ended up working in Huntington's disease.
Well, and it's you have made such a tremendous contribution to supporting this community. And for anybody inside of the US, for sure, you've seen Karen around at different meetings and sharing her expertise and helping others. But internationally, it's great to introduce you to those who haven't had the chance of knowing you and getting to see your tremendous efforts and one-on-one support that you provide this community. But I know many of our team have had the pleasure of working with you and excited to have you join us today.
Thank you. And I'm so glad that you've chosen this topic because, as you said, it's a difficult topic and it impacts so many people. And I think the only way to really help people is to talk about it more and get rid of some of the stigma around it so that people are comfortable letting others know if they're experiencing suicidal thoughts or talking about family members who may have committed suicide, because it does happen more frequently in the HD community.
Absolutely. And I think that that's an important segue to where I wanted to start off with. And I think it's important to talk about what are some of the emotional challenges and physical challenges that happen to people impacted by Huntington's disease, especially young people. We've talked about this a lot, and we continue to do research and information on how the different stages of HD can affect the different stages of life and development and many challenges. But can you share a little bit about specifically what young people go through as they are becoming more aware and are faced with loved ones, themselves going through the different challenges and stages of HD?
Right. I think there are so many challenges faced by young people in HD families. I think that, of course, the first one is realizing that one has a parent who's ill, and that, you know, this upsets all the stability in the family. As that parent becomes sicker, a young person, of course, may end up being a caregiver, which could be a really difficult role for somebody who's, you know, at the point where he or she should be enjoying life and out with friends. And instead, they suddenly have a lot of responsibility in some families. And then, mourning the loss of a parent. So even before the parent dies, the realization that the parent is ill, that they may not be able to show interest in them the way that other parents would. They may not be able to participate in big milestones in their lives the way that other parents would, and sort of mourning that loss and then anticipating the death of the parent. And then at a certain point, and it can be different in different families, the understanding that this is an inherited condition. So, depending on the situation in the family, you may be at risk for inheriting this gene, which means that, you yourself may develop Huntington's at a certain point. And I think as young people think about that, they start to wonder, what is there for me in the future? Should I pursue more school after I finish high school? Should I even finish high school? What, is there, what's the point of all this? And, what does it mean in terms of relationships? Does it mean that other people won't want to date me? They won't want to be with me. Will I have children? So it brings up so many challenging things for people, often really early in life, before most other people even think about those types of things.
And I think it's important to note that it's not a one size fits all, right? Because even the first stage of understanding about Huntington's disease is just knowing about it in your family. And that can happen at age three. It can happen at age 35 and anywhere in between and beyond. And that can be extremely life altering, and where it seems like a normal way to categorize someone is when they first learn about Huntington's disease, but there are so many other life factors that play within that, that the experience really isn't the same for each person. And that's just one factor of HD, let alone the many different other complexities that you laid out.
Exactly. And then I think there's also, the initial experience, as I said, of mourning and then possibly losing a parent, even when you're fairly young, to HD, which can really lead to feelings of abandonment, of course, literal abandonment. And later on in life, that sometimes gets replayed, where someone may be in a dating relationship and the person who they're dating decides when they find out about HD that they're not interested in sticking around. Someone gets genetic testing and they find out that their loved one no longer wants to be with them. Maybe an engagement is broken or a marriage has ended because someone is gene positive for HD. So there are many ways that people can get abandoned throughout HD, and I think that can make it really hard to trust other people sometimes.
Absolutely. And even the fear of the unknown, I think, can sometimes be just as powerful as some things that actually are happening, or those what if statements that you shared, and what does this mean for me and my future? And unknown is just terrifying in of itself, or can be.
Can be, yeah.
So how can you explain a little bit about how those fears and experiences can lead one to have some challenges within their own mental well-being?
Well, as I said, it can make it really hard to think about goals for the future. So I think as humans, we all like to have goals. We like to have things we work toward. We grow up with a group of friends and we watch them, get married and have children and get jobs and advance in their careers. And having HD in the family, being at risk for HD, may make it seem like it's hard to have those goals. It's hard to plan for the future. If you're taking care of a parent with HD, or if your family is impacted economically by HD, you may not be able to do a lot of the things that your peers are able to do in terms of educational opportunities, career opportunities. You may end up, giving up a lot of things because your family is impacted by HD. And I think that can sometimes make it hard for people to stay positive. And hard for people when something negative happens, hard for them to get out of it. Because, as I said, people sometimes have the attitude of, well, what's the point? I'm going to get HD. What's the point of trying for this promotion? What's the point of going to nursing school, if I'm going to have HD eventually? And I think having a lack of goals, or feeling like goals are hard, can really make life a lot more difficult.
So when you have people that you speak with and they mention that they've had either instances of self-harm or thoughts of self-harm, knowing about how difficult it is to talk about this, what would you say to those community members who've ever had those feelings or thoughts?
I'd say that it's really important to share them because even though it's difficult to talk about them, it's really important to talk about them. Often, as you talk about them with someone else, you'll realize, yes, I may think about it as an option, but it's not something I actually want to do right now. I spend a lot of time talking with people who are maybe newly tested gene positive or have known for a while that they have the HD gene expansion, who will say, I think about it in terms of if I'm very ill, if I have a feeding tube, if I'm in a nursing home, at that point I wouldn't want to live. But right now, when I'm 25 years old and I have a job and I have my boyfriend, I'm alive and I'm enjoying life. And I think that, it's really important for people to be able to talk about it as, how they think about it. Because you say, I don't want to end up in a nursing home when you're 25 years old, doesn't mean that you're going to go out and harm yourself. But it's good to be able to talk about this with others for them to understand what you might want in the future and what your goals are for the future.
So you mentioned the importance of sharing that information and talking about it. I think that there are so many different people in one's life who they can speak with. Why in particular do you think it's important to reach out to a professional who has experience with this? Or is it a combination of who you should speak with, whether it's a family or friend? What are some of the benefits of making that reach out to someone who's in the professional or advocacy community if someone's having these thoughts?
I think it is really important if you have family and friends whom you trust, who are supportive people, who you feel, have your best interest at heart. I think it is important to let them know if you're having thoughts of harming yourself. I think they're definitely your first line of help and defense. But sometimes it can be overwhelming for family and friends to hear this. They may be very well-meaning, they may love and care about you, but they may not know what to do. And if they get overwhelmed, it can be hard for them to help you. So I think that's one reason why involving somebody with a mental health background early is really helpful because then you have someone you can talk to, you have someone they can call if they have questions about how things are going or how you're doing. And it doesn't put everything on your family member who's not a professional, doesn't have training in how to deal with this.
I think there's also a little bit of safety in strangers. There are things that you can say to someone who you don't have a personal tie to that you may not feel comfortable sharing, or they might be able to pull even some more feelings outside of you and ask some of those probing questions that, because of personal history, you may actually get offended if a friend or family member asks you. So I think it really is building that community and that village around you to know who you can lean on at what times.
Definitely. That's a really good point.
So, some of the concerns are people who have some of these thoughts, who have access to firearms and weapons. What would you say in that scenario?
Right. I think, especially in the US, this may not apply so much to some of our European audience or others in the world, but especially in the US, there is so much access to firearms. And I would say, first, anybody who owns a firearm, it's your job and responsibility to keep it secured. So you should never have a firearm that's just lying around the house. It should be unloaded and it should be locked away in a gun safe. I think if somebody's struggling with mental health issues, the first question is the firearm secured? If it is, could you give the key to the gun safe to someone else? And that's a really simple thing. You're not taking someone's firearm away, but you're giving them a break from access to it. We have this thing in psychiatry called means reduction, which means slowing people down, right? So if someone has a thought that they want to harm themselves, if you can delay it for even a few minutes, not, it doesn't need to be hours or days, but even a few minutes, the time that someone has to go and find you and get the key from the gun safe from you and then come back and unlock it, during that time, it's likely that the thought will pass and they will not harm themselves. So that's certainly an excellent way to deal with it. If there is more concern or if someone doesn't want to give up the keys to the gun safe, then you may want to call a local gun shop or a shooting range to find out, is there a secure way to store your gun outside of the home? There are legal issues with just giving it to a friend or relative who's not licensed to have a gun. So it's much better to check with a shooting range or a gun store to see if there's someone there who could hang on to the gun for a few weeks while the issues are resolved.
I think those are really good tangible tips, and especially about kind of creating some of those obstacles and that delay that you mentioned, because sometimes those thoughts can be fleeting, and through different breathing exercises or other tools or talking about it, one may not can decide to act on that. So I think that that's a really interesting point and an important point. Another concern is drug and alcohol addiction and abuse. What are your thoughts on how to handle that situation?
Right. So, obviously, if you're struggling with drug or alcohol abuse, I'd urge you to get help, regardless of whether you have suicidal thinking. In my experience, people who have the HD gene expansion don't do as well if they're heavily abusing drugs and alcohol. So, I urge people to get help. But particularly if you're struggling with mental health issues, drugs and alcohol will only make it worse. It may relieve the symptoms for a while, but then when they come back, they're going to be worse. Drugs and alcohol are going to make you disinhibited so that you're more likely to try to harm yourself. So I really urge you to try to get help for that if you're struggling with addiction in addition to thoughts of harming yourself.
There are some treatments out there and some medications where it says that there could be some, if you stop taking your medicine or add medicine, medication, could that change your ideas of suicidal ideation? Could that make you be suicidal? What would your feedback and advice be on that?
So I think that there was some really well-meaning research on antidepressants and suicide that unfortunately the conclusions from it were not so helpful. So the thing to remember is that a lot of people who take antidepressant medicine have suicidal thoughts. So when they looked at the association between taking an antidepressant and being suicidal, of course it was there. And that led them to put warnings on some antidepressants saying these are associated with suicidal thinking. But they don't address the issue that it's in a population where people have suicidal thoughts because they're depressed. So, in my view, taking an antidepressant will not make you more suicidal. So, it's important to remember this. Occasionally, somebody will get more activated by an antidepressant. So, we all know the people who are, very slowed down, they're sleeping a lot, they're not motivated when they're depressed. They get on an antidepressant and then suddenly they're more motivated. In those cases, sometimes people will start to have more active suicidal thoughts just because their motivation comes back. So, again, it's important to let your prescribing doctor know, and to seek help if that happens. If you're on an antidepressant or another drug for mental health and you decide to stop it or your prescription runs out, sometimes the suicidal thoughts can come back. So that's why it's really important if you're on a medication, try to be as consistent as possible. If there's an insurance issue, call someone to get help getting the prescription filled somehow. There are lots of low-cost options if you need to switch to another medication because your insurance doesn't cover what you have. So it's really important to be consistent with your psychiatric medications to really maintain your mood at an even level.
I think too, again, arming yourself with this community around you who could maybe bring some of that to your attention as well, because you may think that you are behaving the same with or without medicine if you have had to stop taking it for a while, but they may notice some things, or you may be noticing some things internally about having difficulty coping, or some of these little, seemingly small changes that can add up really quickly, but having that openness to be able to communicate that with whomever is close to you that you trust is helpful, because they maybe can call you out on some of those things and help you navigate through some of those seemingly subtle changes that are starting to make an impact.
Definitely, yeah.
So I think one of the fears that I hear from the community too is if they are open with their thoughts, are they going to be hospitalized and what's going to happen to me? if that happens and I do have to go to the hospital for these thoughts, what would you say to that individual?
I would say it's better to go to the hospital than to harm yourself and end up severely injuring yourself or actually taking your own life. If you express suicidal thoughts and you have to go to the hospital, you'll go into the emergency room, most likely, and a nurse or a social worker or a doctor will do an intake interview with you and talk about the thoughts, about what the risks are, about why you're having these thoughts right now. They will likely want to talk to a family member to see, how things have been going for you and get someone else's view on how you're doing. And, they'll make an assessment there of whether or not you need to come into the hospital. If you need to come into the hospital, you'll go to a psychiatric unit, which will most likely be locked. So it will mean that you have to stay there until you can leave. But people are not put away on psychiatric units for months and months and months. So the current model is, you're in for a few days, your medications are stable. They may get you set up with a therapist. They may get you into an outpatient program where you can go and get therapy in groups every day, but you can go home and sleep in your own bed at night. I often tell people that going to the hospital can fast track a lot of services that we try to piece together that can take months to get together. If you go in the hospital, they're very motivated to get a lot of services in place really fast for you. So it's difficult to be in the hospital. I won't say that it's fun or enjoyable, but it can really help you. It can give you a safe place to just take a break for a few days. And sometimes that's all someone needs. Somebody doesn't need medication. They don't need long-term therapy. They just need to get out of a situation for a few days so they can reflect on it and think about what needs to change.
Yes, and I think it's important to note that that is indicative of US health systems, but also can be similar with other health systems as well. And there may be some cultural challenges that you may be facing where it makes it more challenging to openly go to the hospital. But I encourage you to reach out and we can chat through some of those challenges and see where is a safe place that you could go, or local associations or those support systems that you have. Because it can feel stigmatized, and we know that there are many cultures out there where it can be seen from others and make you feel kind of out there and alone. So we want to make sure that if you do need that professional support, that we can help guide you and help support you. So let's change it a little bit to friends and family members who are out there and they're worried about someone. What would you recommend that they do? In their perspective, they may have fears that asking an individual loved one about suicide specifically will actually put that back into their mind and make them start to think about it if they haven't already. So that real fear of if I bring it up, am I going to be the cause of someone's decision to complete suicide? So what would be your advice to those family members and friends who are curious about that?
So I would say if you have any concern that someone is thinking about harming him or herself, it's always better to ask about it and just have it out in the open rather than worrying about it and wondering about it and trying to read someone's mind. They've done studies on this and they found that asking about suicide does not make somebody decide to go out and harm themselves. If you ask someone and he or she does make an attempt, they were going to do it anyhow. It's not something that you've caused, and chances are you'll prevent someone from harming him or herself. So it's really important to ask about it if you have any doubts at all or any concerns.
Now, they're flipping that back. Let's say that you do want to call emergency services on behalf of someone that you love, and that person is threatening to never speak with them again, and they're throwing these really statements of absolute, where I will not be a part of your life. I'm going to hate you forever if you call this number or get someone to help out. How would you address that situation?
Again, I would say, what's the most important thing, which is keeping that person alive. So, yes, they may say, I'll hate you. I'll never talk to you. You'll be completely cut off from me. And my answer to that would be, okay, but at least you'll be safe, right? You have to accept that almost 99% of the time, people will not follow through on that. They'll be grateful once they feel better, or at the worst, they'll grudgingly talk with you again. So it's, if people are making threats like that and you're concerned they're going to harm themselves, you have to just go ahead and get help for them. And again, remember the most important thing is preserving someone's safety in life.
This has been a lot of really important information, and I think a lot of these topics and things that we're talking about has to do with open communication, and it can sometimes be really uncomfortable to bring it up and scary to actually say it out loud, but really building the support system around you of whomever you feel the safest with is this continual theme, and to being open about this. So how are some ways that we can prevent one's mental health to get to this stage of where they feel like this is the option? What are some of the things that you really would recommend for people to start thinking about now, even before they think that they won't get to that point? They may be at the beginning of their journey, or they might be in the middle of just being go, 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 and don't have the time to stop and think about things. What are some tools that we can equip the community to better help prevent this, these feelings?
I think one of the biggest ones is the one that we've talked about quite a bit, of course, is having family and friends. So taking the time to get other people involved in your life, taking the time, and I know it's hard if you're raising a family and you're working and very busy, but taking the time to have friendships and have people who know you and care about you is huge. I certainly recommend gratitude. So taking a few minutes each day to think about what are the things that made me happy. What are the things that I'm really grateful that I have in my life? Because it can be really helpful, especially if you like to write those down and then you can reflect on them later. When you start to have negative thoughts, then you have a list of things that are positive, things that you live for. That's a really common question that I ask people when I'm evaluating them for suicidal thinking. What are the things that keep you getting up every morning? What are the things that you look forward to? What do you live for? So having those kind of things in your life. Working on healthier habits. And again, I know when you're very busy, it's hard, but trying to eat healthy food, which will help you to have a better mindset, trying to get even just a little bit of exercise, even a 10-minute walk every day outside in the fresh air, and trying to stay on a normal schedule, in that you're getting a lot of sleep, and you're not up late at night on screens, not spending lots and lots of time on social media and avoiding real people. I think those are all the kind of things that we should all do. But I always urge people from HD families to really, really try for those things because those healthy habits, if you start them early on in life, they'll stay with you as you develop symptoms of HD.
I think too, just involvement and engagement is really crucial, and you've hinted on this, and I want to even broaden this a little bit more with knowing that not everybody comes from a family structure where they have the confidence or the freedom to be able to talk about it within their family structure. But there are so many ways for you to get involved that allow you to still do so at an arm's length away, but still connects you to the community. And I'm a firm believer in safety in strangers and numbers. And with HD specifically in rare diseases, sometimes you don't have the luxury to immediately see that you are a part of this community. And things like going to events to where you can talk with others and meet others, going to get involved with things like the HDYO Ambassador Program is really helpful because there are ways to participate where you get to choose your own journey and how open you are. But at the very base of it, you hear from others who may be going through very similar things, and knowing that you're not alone can really help with that mental well-being. So I think, at the very least, reaching out to local associations, to us, to other professionals, to other friends, to be able to say, how can I broaden my community and getting involved, and what are my goals? And I think allowing us to help you do that is really important.
Definitely. I think that it depends on the support group, but there are some support groups where you can come and just listen. You don't have to turn on your camera. I'm talking about the virtual ones. You can just listen. And I think, as you said, just understanding that there are other people going through the same thing can make it seem a lot less lonely for people.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's just, we're here to help. We're all here for you and help to give you those tools. And it's just really important to have these conversations, as awkward and as scary as they can be. Well, Dr. Anderson, this is amazing. Thank you so much for taking the time to share your thoughts. I wanted to leave it with you for any closing thoughts that you'd like to have to address this community.
Again, I'm just so happy, Jenna, that you decided to do a feature on this. I think it's such an important topic, and I think we don't talk enough about it in the HD community. And if any of you who see this are struggling, please reach out to someone, reach out to a family member, someone from your spiritual community, faith community, or if there's a professional you trust, or make a new relationship. Call your local Huntington's clinic or your local doctor's office. And let them know that you're struggling because you're not alone, and there are people out there who've been through this who can help you get through it.
That's great advice. Well, thank you again, and thank you for all who are watching. Again, we're here to help connect you to any resources that you may need. We're only an email away. Stay connected through us through social media, website, different support groups. Get connected with your local associations and clinics, just like Dr. Anderson said. And just know you're not alone. We're all here for you, and we're so grateful for this opportunity to bring this topic to light in this manner. And we know that this is just one part of the conversation, and we'll definitely continue it as we go forward, especially with our in-person programs and opportunities for learning and support. Well, thank you all so much for taking the time today to watch. This is another edition of our Breaking Down Barriers, and we're looking forward to continuing this program, and we hope you all have a great day. Thank you, Dr. Anderson.
Thank you.